So I introduce myself. I am the next speaker, so it's easy. So for the people who arrived a few minutes ago, so I am Thierry Palin-Luc from Arts et Métiers Paris Tech in Bordeaux campus. I ask to the colleagues here to show me when there will be 2 minutes before the end of the talk to respect the time. So the title of my presentation is a review about the gigacycle fatigue strengths of steel, and we will focus on the microstructural and operating factors that govern the very high cycle fatigue strengths of this type of material. It has been prepared in cooperation with my colleague, Dr. Dalanda Jedi from Tunis University. So a brief introduction. In fact, as probably you know, the high cycle fatigue strength of material, of steel especially, is governed by a lot of factors for components like the roughness, the residual stresses, the environment, the defects, the microstructures, the size effect, the volume that is loaded, or the stress gradient, and etc., etc. But in fact, for the very high cycle fatigue strengths of materials, there are not a lot of studies about that, so we will try to have an overview of what we can conclude from a literature review about that. So after this brief introduction, my talk is divided in three main parts. First, we will talk about the failure mechanisms of steel in very high cycle fatigue regime. Then we will see the effect of the microstructures and the mechanical parameters of the test that we are carrying out in labs. And then we will see the effects of the loading conditions, I mean the testing conditions, the testing machine, and how we interpret the results, before to conclude and to see some prospects for further studies. So first, about the failure mechanism. This presentation is divided in two parts or two types of steel. I categorize in high-strength steel for a maximum tensile strength greater than 1,100 megapascal, and for low-strength steel. So first, for the high-strength steel, that are the type 2 materials according to Mughrabi, that is the materials with inclusion, with precipitates, etc., that are the non-pure material. I do not talk about non-pure or about pure materials, because this is not for a structural application. So as probably you know, in a very high cycle fatigue regime, around 10 to the 8, 10 to the 9 and more cycles, many people know that most of the time crack initiation is internal. But it's not a generality. We will see that for the low strength steel, it is different. But for high strength steel, it is internal crack initiation. And the main important reason of that is the role played by inclusions, which are the local notches or the local defects creating the crack initiation, and there is also an important role played by the large grains when there is an heterogeneous microstructure with a mixture between a small grain and large grain. And it is important also to see that there is a competition between inclusion and the surface. So if the material has a very good surface or the component is polished, inclusion is the trigger of the initiation. And after initiation, the typical features of the fracture surface is with the fish eyes that you can see here, for instance, from Murakami papers. And in these fish eyes, as you see in the plenary lecture by Yushi Ong, there is a fine granular area or an optical dark area or a gray bright facet. There are different names for characterizing the same area around the center of the initiation where there is an inclusion usually. Has been shown by Batias, Murakami, Shan, etc. So you can see here a picture of a typical fish eyes and the inclusion in the center of the fish eyes responsible for the initiation. So this is typical for a gigacycle regime and the initiation. So below the famous fatigue limit, which doesn't exist anymore, it has been shown by many people. So for high strength steel and the structural application, it has been shown that there is no asymptotic tendency of the SN curve. Usually we have a duplex SN curve like this or like this one. We can name that stepwise SN curve. Why there is the fine granular area and the fish eyes? We can summarize the different model and the different reason of that in 5 cases. It has been presented with a little bit different classification by Professor Ong in Tuesday. Anyway, the first proposition about the reason of this internal inclusion, internal clock initiation, has been proposed by Murakami and then other colleagues about hydrogen embrittlement, hydrogen that is trapped around the inclusions. There is also a model that is proposed by Shi Ozawa that is the breakage or the debonding between the particle and the matrix. There is also several models and the heritage of Professor Charniewski that leads to the model proposed by Yu Xiong and presented Tuesday, numerocyclic pressing, that is, we can observe around the internal inclusion plasticity around the inclusion and sometimes severe plastic flow that can be assessed by the cyclic pressing or not. There is also grain refinement, and then after the grain refinement, polygonization and debonding. It is correlated also with the model proposed by Shi Ozawa. And there is also more recently an interesting paper published by Pino and Forrest, who remind that there is an important difference between the mechanical properties of inclusion and matrix, and also a difference between the thermal expansion coefficient of inclusion and matrix in many steels. So if you have a test that is carrying out at high frequency, we will see that sometimes the material is self-heated, and in this case, the thermal expansion coefficient difference play an important role. And there is also, in some less cases, defects-free materials that where there is an internal crack initiation. It has been shown the first time by Shea and then by Zhao and Gao. And in this case, there are subsurface crack initiation without any inclusion, without any defects. So we can observe that sometimes, and it's still a little bit an open question. We do not exactly why there is this type of internal inclusion. And now, if we have a look on the low strength steel, so for low strength steel, it is completely different. But there are less studies published, probably because for low strength steel, there is less application for structural components. But for low strength steel, there is crack initiation at the surface, not inside the material, even at 10 to the 9 cycles. And also, the SN curve has not several plateaus. Maybe there is not a strict asymptote, but there is a quasi-horizontal asymptote. So it means it is very different. But I didn't find a lot of papers. I found 4 papers about that. There are not many studies, so it's difficult to conclude and to be very categoric about that. Anyway, I think it's important to keep in mind that internal inclusion is not always the phenomena. Sometimes there is also surface crack initiation. So now, let me have a look about the effect of the microstructures. We will not talk about inclusion only, and about the mechanical features. We will talk about the coupling between microstructure and temperature. We'll talk again about inclusion, the effect of external environment, and also about residual stresses. So about the microstructures, as you know, there are 2 types to do a fatigue test in an ultra-high cycle fatigue regime. Either you let a machine running less than 1 year, or at least 10 months at a classic frequency, around 100 Hertz, or you do ultrasonic fatigue test. For ultrasonic fatigue test, depending on the material, you may have a material without self-heating and material with very pronounced self-heating. The specimen can heat itself without external heating up to more than 200 degrees Celsius, sometimes around 300 degrees Celsius. So of course there is a problem that arise. Is there an effect of the temperature of the specimen on the mechanism of crack initiation? So in fact, it has been shown in literature that, of course, the temperature due to self-heating can induce microstructure transformation in some case, but not always, because in fact, 200 degrees Celsius, it's lower than the phase transformation temperature for steel, but anyway, it can affect the crack initiation mechanism. I remind you the paper I cited by Pino and Forrest that at this temperature, if you have an inclusion with a given thermal expansion coefficient and a matrix with another one, of course there is a problem of strain compatibility, and that's why the inclusion may be critical. But in literature, there is an interesting paper published by Zhong Huang at the end of the last century, showing that you may observe a microstructural transformation at ultrasonic frequency, even if the specimen is below 60 degrees. So it means in this case, there is no pronounced self-heating. But in fact, due to the plasticity transformation of blocky retain austenite in martensitic steel with a few percentage of austenite, we may observe this type of coupling. And we may also observe on a duplex steel the plastic deformation of the Bennett lattes. So in this case, if you have a material with a few percentage of a smooth phase, I mean a phase with the high capacity to plasticize, this is a critical link in the microstructure, and the crack initiation and the self-heating appears due to the plasticity of this phase. So it has to be understood that in fact the microstructure transformation, I wrote instability, it's not exactly correct. We can think microstructure transformation is not due always to the temperature. It can be due to the fact that the plasticity appears in one phase and then it induces temperature heating or self-heating. It has been shown also in an interesting recent paper by Bach and co-worker on a steel with a low ferrite content. Steel with ferrite and perlite, and you can see here for three steels, the red point shows the steel with a higher ferrite content, and the dark point shows the steel with a higher perlite content. So it means with low ferrite, and we can see that when the ferrite decreases, there is a significant increase of the fatigue strength at 10 to the 8. So it shows that the ferrite phase is the critical link in the microstructures. If we come back a little bit about inclusion, I talk about the key role of inclusion already, but you can see also that many people know that to form the fish eyes, it needs a lot of time, it needs a lot of cycles. So probably the phenomena for creating the fish eyes is due to a cumulative process, probably to microplastic strain accumulation and maybe other factors. Up to now, it is still open. There is no model to explain why a crack initiation shifts from the surface to the core, especially when there is no inclusion. Also, it is open. We do not know exactly why. We know that this is the case. The location of the inclusion compared to the surface is a key point, but we don't know exactly why. It's still an open question. And we have also for industrial application, for real components loaded at 10 to the 9 cycle or 10 to the 10, that there is a competition between the roughness and the defects inside the material. It has been shown by Itoga that if you have a material with a very good roughness, we have duplex SN curve and internal crack initiation, but if the surface is rough, in this case, there is no effect of the defects inside. Everything appears at the surface. At the surface, there is also the coupling with the environment. It has been shown that after the work, the famous work by Endo in the middle of the last century, that even in the gigacycle regime, there is a strong effect of the corrosive environment. The key effect is due to the corrosion pits. Like in high cycle fatigue regime, the cracks start at the pits. And even if the loading is done at a very high frequency, it has been shown here in a PhD thesis I supervised about that, even at 20 kHz, you can see here compared to the test in air or in a pre-corroded environment, that if you do the test in a seawater environment, the decrease is very, very important. And of course, this is in agreement with a well-known vacuum effect, because the vacuum decreases the crack growth rate. So this is in agreement with a very long incubation time for internal very short cracks. About the residual stresses, it is very difficult to conclude, because in fact, there is only a few papers about that. We know that in high cycle fatigue regime, compressive stress increases the fatigue strength. And I found only two papers about that. And you can see that it seems to be the same case here. When there is a shot pinning inducing compressive residual stresses, it increases the fatigue strength. So it seems the same like in high cycle fatigue. But we don't know we don't know if the residual stresses are stable, because in high cycle fatigue, it is known that the residual stresses may relax. In ultra high cycle fatigue, we do not know. So just, I am a little bit long, so I will just conclude about this part. What we can say about loading frequency and highly stressed volume. The most important thing that you have to keep in mind is that when we do a test, usually in high cycle fatigue regime, the specimen diameter is around 10 or 15 millimeters. But when we do a test in ultrasonic frequency to reach 10 to the 9th cycle, the specimen is very small, typically 3 millimeters. And there is an effect of size, because the probability to find defects in a specimen for ultra high cycle fatigue is very small compared to a test with conventional specimen. And if you take into account this size effect, there is in fact no pure frequency effect for high strength steel. It has been shown by several papers. So in fact, for high strength steel, an apparent frequency effect is a consequence of a size effect. There is no effect of the, no, there is a classical effect of the loading ratio. It has been shown, you can predict the mean stress effect by a Heck diagram. It is very easy, like in high cycle fatigue regime. And then I finish with that. Many people in different labs use two types of tests at ultrasonic frequency, either continuous test or pulse and pause. But nobody studies the effect of pulse and pause, because when you do a pulse and pause test, the loading signal is like that, depending on the ratio between the pulse and the pause. There are different configurations. In this case, it is a test under variable amplitude, and we don't know exactly how this test condition affect the fatigue life, so I think it should be interesting to compare. So I have finished. The conclusion is there. You may have a look, and I think if you want to read additional things, there is a new paper published in Fatigue and Fracture, where you can find a lot of details.